Thanks, Scott. Thank you all for coming tonight. We're going to start off by allowing any candidates who are on Haywood County ballot, except for the county commissioners, to come up and speak tonight. We have some school board candidates in attendance. We also have some state legislative candidates in attendance. So the first person I'd like to call, if you come up the stage this way, is Kay Miller.
Good evening. Thank you for being here this evening. And yes, I'm Kay Miller, and I am originally from Greenville, South Carolina. I've lived in Haywood County just almost 12 and a half years. I'm married to Richard Miller, and I have a stepson, Andy Miller, and I'm a small business owner in downtown Waynesville and a member of New Covenant Church in Clyde. After earning my MBA from Texas Christian University, I worked as the Director of Administration for the St. Louis Symphony Community Music School. I oversaw the daily operations of 7 school branches, 4,000 students, 14 staff, and 90 faculty members. I was also in charge of scholarships, financial aid, and registration. In 2004, I was hired as Executive Director of the Haywood County Arts Council, a position I held for a little over 8.5 years. During that time, I developed working relationships with Dr. Garrett, Dr. Douglas, Jenny Wood, teachers, and principals to bring art, music, and poetry residencies and live orchestra and dance performances to Haywood County school children. Whether we have children in school or not, we are stakeholders in the public school system. Our future workforce, our economic vitality, and sustainability depend on the educational decisions that we make now. I'm running for Haywood County School Board because I want to increase communication and rebuild trust between the board and the community it serves. I want to improve teacher morale and ensure that our teachers are receiving the support and encouragement they need to be successful. And I want to rebuild the fund balance. The emergency fund for the school system has dropped from $5.2 million to just a little over $1 million since 2012. I know we can work together as a community to find local solutions to our unique educational challenges. And growing up in the foothills of South Carolina, my parents taught me the same mountain values as here: love of God, love of country and family, hard work, and a sense of community. Along with those mountain values, I'll bring a new perspective to the Haywood County School Board. And whether you're voting early or you're voting on Election Day, Tuesday, November 8th, I ask you to vote Kay Miller.
Next up, we're going to call another school board candidate, Rebecca Benhart. I think just to keep things moving here, I'm going to let you all know who's up on deck. So Mr. Clampett, Mike Clampett, if you want to get ready after Ms. Benhart.
Time limits, I'll just give you a few of my proposals to benefit our schools. Haywood County lost 24 teachers last year. For the past 8 years, our teachers have received a 4 to 5% supplement. Buncombe County has a 8 to 16% supplement. Wake County has a whopping 23%. Where do you think a lot of teachers want to go? I propose at least 10% for our hardworking teachers who have made us number 11 in the state. Isn't that amazing? All the school districts in the state were number 11. North Carolina requires seatbelts when riding in a vehicle, or you'll get a ticket if you don't click it. They're not provided on school buses. Students are our future. They deserve the same protection when riding a school bus. Both concepts rely on county commission providing funds. We need to lobby the commission in a big way. Any county of 60,000 people that can spend $3.7 million for an animal shelter can surely do better by its students. This is my biggie. Homework. After their full-time day job at school, students have chores, activities, family life, and sleep needs, leaving little time for the stress of homework. However, we must always encourage reading. I want to build bridges, promote teamwork, and bring positive energy to the school board. Due to our fantastic teachers and hardworking students, Haywood is in the top 10% of the state. Given the necessary funding, we'll find it easier to be number one. Thank you.
Rebecca Benhart, everyone. Mike Clampett is next, Representative Queen, if you're, like, take your place, you're on deck.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I am Mike Clampett. I'm from Swain County. I'm a sixth-generation Mountaineer from Swain County. I'm a product of public school and the community college system. In the community college system, I trained as a machinist, and believe it or not, a far direction I went from that was into public service as being a firefighter. I careered and was captain with the Charlotte Fire Department for 28 years. Being from Swain County, I have traditional mountain values. The thing about it is, I grew up in L.A. there, which is Laura Larkin, the son. But anyhow, over half my life has been spent in public service. That public service is, I'm not afraid to make decisions as a fire captain. Whenever a place is burning down, somebody had to do something. And not just doing something was just not doing something. You had to have a plan. You had to put together and formulate and execute the opportunity to mitigate the circumstance of a person's house burning down, or do the rescue, or get the person out of the trapped car. I want to continue my life in public service and be your representative, a true representative, one that can be contacted. Someone that when you call my cell phone, which by the way, call my cell phone, I'll answer it. There's not a staff person to take that or anything. You won't be given a wait 3 minutes or leave your message. I'm not used to giving up. A lot of you know I've run against Mr. Queen now my third time. And I believe that this is the time, because Mr. Queen's been down there 4 years, two terms. As an EMT on the fire department, we don't make promises we don't keep to patients, to make promises that, hey, everything's going to be okay. It wouldn't be okay, we wouldn't be there. My one promise to you is when I'm elected, I'll spend no more than two terms in the state house. That's 4 years. You've had 4 years of Mr. Queen. He has introduced no bills that have been passed from the committee and onto the floor. You've paid for a representative that has done nothing. And what I'm telling you is, I'm not saying it's going to be what I'm going to do for you. Sometimes it's what you don't do that's important. My guiding principles are three books: the Bible, the state constitution, and the federal constitution. I believe in the Bible.
Amen.
The reason I do that, I will say Christ is my Savior, but also with that being said, is I'm pro-life.
Amen.
I have been endorsed by the North Carolina Right to Life, and that's for the rights of the unborn, newborn, and the elderly. And that's something new that we're facing today. Some laws, some folks are asking for more laws for people at the end of their life. That should be a decision between that person and their caregiver. The government should not have any influence in that. The next thing is, I'm another one of those God-fearing, adorable deplorables that's a gun toter. Yes, Second Amendment rights are important, and important to the state constitution and the federal constitution. So much so, the NRA has endorsed me in this election, and Grassroots North Carolina has endorsed me in this election. That's an two endorsements you'll never see Mr. Queen ever get. North Carolina Right to Life and NRA. I'm a leader in small business. NFIB is a National Federation of Independent Business. I think independent small businesses are the backbone of Swain, Jackson, and Haywood counties. Small businesses, or all businesses, start out as a small business. So with that being said, is we need to, and have made by the General Assembly for the last 4 years, with the governor, the State House, and the Senate, has made North Carolina's climate much better for small business and business in North Carolina by reducing the corporate income tax, the personal income tax, taking away and sunsetting a tax of 1%. With that being said, I also ask for your vote to be, like I say, a true representative, someone that you can talk to. Pretend you're calling your mom or dad and you're off at college and you need to talk to them about a problem. I want to be that problem solver, because that's all I've done for my life and career. Mr. Queen has advertised he'll work with anyone. His latest mail-out says, let's all join hands and form a big circle, and he will work with everyone. I worked down there 2 years as sergeant-at-arms. I saw his work. He voted straight with party lines every time. Representative Fredell Presnell is here tonight, had some legislation she needed help with. Mr. Queen didn't help her. I'm there to work with the other legislators, because Haywood County is a very unique county. It is divided and has two representatives in the State House. We have to be in lockstep. We have to work together, irregardless of party affiliation, if we are party different. I'm hoping it'll be Representative Brazell. Those of you who live in her district, please support her. And those that live in my district, support me. And we can work together to make a greater Haywood County. Remember, early voting has already started and will go through November the 5th. I'm asking for your vote. I'm asking for your support. And I'm asking you to tell your friends and neighbors. What have you got to lose? Nothing, because you've got nothing. Zero from zero is zero. You have everything to gain tonight and in this election for 2016. I'm Mike Clampett. I'm asking for your vote. I'm asking to be your employee in Raleigh. I want to work for you. Each of you have safe travels tonight, and God bless you each and every one.
Representative Joe Sam Queen.
Thank you. I want to thank Smoky Mountain News for holding the forum. I want to thank Folk Moot for hosting the forum. And I want to thank each of you for coming out and listening to the issues of this election. This is a very important election. It's an election for our state to recommit to public education, to lead and not lag. Since the recession, our state in real dollars has cut student funding $600 plus. We've cut our university funding over $800 million, while we've raised tuition over 50%. We've added over 80% to community college tuition, while cutting per student funding at the community college over $1,000. This is not the North Carolina I grew up in and most of us grew up in and knew. We were the education state of the South, a leader in America, the first state in the nation to have a public university, the first state in the nation to have a community college system, the first state in the nation to have pre-K early childhood education
sponsored by the public. We are a great state and we need to get back to our commitment to public education. Second, this is an election to protect our state waters and stop fracking before it can begin. Our state constitution says it shall be the policy of the state of North Carolina to protect the water, the air, and the land for the benefit of all the citizens. When we poison our groundwater for a quick buck, for a few political payoffs and pals, and it's poisoned forever, I can't imagine a policy that's more against our Constitution, our values, and our future. It's at stake in this election. This is an election to expand Medicaid to serve over 15,000 of our neighbors in Haywood, Jackson, and Swain County, and create over 1,000 jobs here serving our neighbors with health care. When they talk about freight, waste, fraud, and abuse, we are wasting in this state, this governor and this General Assembly, $2.5 billion a year, $5 billion this last session, $5 billion at risk in this election, in the next session, $5 billion. Every $1 million of our tax dollars invested in our citizens' health care lost, but every one of those dollars, if invested, every $1 million would create 10 primary jobs at $100,000 apiece and 10 secondary jobs following. That's hundreds of thousands of jobs across our state and well over 1,000 in this district. Real good jobs. Here, we do not need to sell our health care to HMOs, cap and cut our health care for our citizens. We need to do the responsible thing. Quit wasting our tax dollars and start helping our economy and our citizens. And it's past time to bring high-speed internet to everybody in North Carolina, everybody in Western North Carolina, everywhere. It would be a public policy that would help education, help healthcare, help small business, help big business, help every child, every school system, every aspect of our great state and every citizen in our great state. It's time that that became public policy. This governor and this budget we just passed, when he presented his budget, he had $0 for broadband expansion in North Carolina, the most critical and important infrastructure investment to help everybody in North Carolina. My campaign slogan, as Mr. Clampett said, is let's join hands in one big circle. Let's all join hands. I'll tell you what I didn't do in this last session of the legislature is I worked hard to help put the NC Connect bond in front of the citizens, so that they could decide if they wanted to invest in their future. And in my district, I got $117 million worth of projects in that bond, and it passed in all three of my counties and 99 counties in the state. There weren't enough Republican votes to pass it in the Senate or the House. It was a true bipartisan effort, and I worked hard on my side to make sure my colleagues were supporting the opportunity for the citizens to decide if they wanted to invest in their future, and they did. If you divide the 120 state House members by the $2 billion bond, you get about $17 or $18 million per legislator, per House member. I got $117 million in my district. So I don't think I have been sitting on my laurels and not supporting the people's needs in my district. I fight for them every day in every way. And I want to join together with others, anybody, everybody across this great state, for creating opportunities for all, health care for all, education for all. Everything I do is nonpartisan and bipartisan in its character. It's jobs for everybody. It's education for everybody. It's a clean and healthy and secure environment for everybody. It is opportunity for all. I try to work in that way across every sector of the folks in Raleigh, and I will continue to do so on your behalf. So, what I ask of you is your continued support, because working together, we are stronger. And our brightest days are yet to come. I'm quite confident of that. So again, this is an important election cycle. Be mindful, be vigilant, and I ask for your support. And may God bless you, and may the great state of North Carolina be all it can ever be. Thank you.
Ron DeChandelier, he's the next, followed up by Representative Presnell. Good
evening. As many of you know, my name is Rhonda Cole Shanaval, and I am a candidate for the North Carolina House of Representatives. I was born and raised right here in Haywood County. I'm the daughter of Wanda and the late D. Cole. Together, they taught my brother and me the values of what it means to be a member of this community. Values like participating in our democracy, helping out a neighbor in need, being honest and willing to work hard. These are values that I want to take to Raleigh. You see, my mom worked in a small business for over 30 years, and Daddy worked in the Canton paper mill. They taught me hard work meant that any dirt you could wash off your hands at the end of the day was clean dirt. But Raleigh politicians like my opponent don't seem to place a value on hard work required by blue-collar jobs. My opponent will rush to say that she saved the Canton Mill, when in reality, other members of the legislature led the charge while she took the credit. Those aren't mountain values. That's called playing politics. I spent my entire educational career in North Carolina public schools, as did my husband and my son. It has made us who we are today. I want to keep our children safe and make sure they receive a world-class education right here in our mountains. That's why when I saw our schools struggling, I stepped up and ran for the Haywood County Board of Education. And because of the great educators, administrators, and hard work of our students, we now rank in the top 10% of all school districts in North Carolina. And no thanks to Raleigh politicians. When I get to Raleigh, I will fight to better our schools and push for more resources for programs like band, art, and our vocational programs. We all know that we need more good-paying jobs in these mountains, and that all starts with having a well-educated workforce. My opponent has voted for budgets that cut teacher assistance by the thousands, underfunded textbooks, and allowed for educator pay to rank 41st in the nation. These are not the votes of someone that cares about public education. When I get to Raleigh, I want to fight for our families, not do what my opponent has done and sell out to special interests. Today, North Carolina families are paying more in taxes than billion-dollar companies. My opponent has raised taxes on mobile homes and truck repairs, while giving tax breaks to jet owners and big corporations that ship North Carolina jobs overseas. She's raised taxes and fees on small businesses, school supplies, home repairs, on childbirths, and even funerals. Also, companies like ExxonMobil could keep their tax breaks. These aren't the votes of someone that holds our mountain values. I believe that we need an economy that produces for all North Carolina families, where hard work is rewarded and everyone plays by the same rules. When I get to Raleigh, I want to make sure our state employees and retirees are treated with the respect they deserve. And I want to do this every year, not just in an election year. My opponent voted to cut unemployment benefits, voted against the living wage, and made it harder for working men and women in our state to get by. I want our state employees to be able to live, work, and retire with dignity. That means instituting annual pay raises. That means a real cost of living adjustment every year. And that means that retirees and their spouse should be able to keep their health care. When I get to Raleigh, I'm going to protect our drinking waters and our trout streams. We live in one of the most beautiful places on the face of this earth, and I want to keep it that way for generations to come. That is why I'm disgusted that my opponent has voted to allow fracking in our beautiful mountains that jeopardizes our drinking waters. I am disgusted that she voted to send our first responders and law enforcement officers to jail if they disclose the chemicals used in fracking. And I am disgusted that she continues to stand up and lie by saying that there is no shale under these mountains when the North Carolina Geological Survey tells us that there is. When I get to Raleigh, I'm going to hold corporate polluters accountable and make sure they pay to clean up their own mess. My opponent voted to give Duke Energy almost everything they wanted in a bill that should have protected us. She gave them more time to clean up their mess that is poisoning our drinking waters, and then she stuck us with a bill. Those are not mountain values. That's selling out to Raleigh's special interests. Folks, I'm from here. I am one of y'all, and I know what is good for this region that I have called home for my entire life. That's why I'm running for this office. The bottom line is, I'm going to go to work every single day thinking about you and your families, not special interests. My name is Rhonda Cole Chanteville, and I would appreciate your vote. Thank you, and God bless.
Representative Prisnell, everyone.
Thank you very much. I'm Michelle Prisnell. I represent Haywood, Madison, and Yancey County. I live in Yancey. You know, when I get down in there, I want you to know I will continue our Republican-led lowest unemployment in 9 years. We have created over 300,000 jobs. None of this gets done by one person or one vote. This takes a lot of people that you have to deal with to vote on those bills. If you're not down there, you don't hardly understand that kind of thing. North Carolina has outperformed the nation, in terms of income and job growth. We cut taxes, making North Carolina the second best place for business. Our tax climate ranking from 44th to the 13th in the nation. Amount of income when you pay no taxes used to be, when the Democrats were in control, $6,000. We upped that to $17,500 of your hard-earned money that you pay no taxes on in North Carolina. We have got a historic teacher pay raise, 4.7%. The average teacher is now making $50,000 a year. I've been endorsed by the North Carolina Right to Life. My opponent has been endorsed by Lillian's List and Emily's List. I want you to know that some of these abortions can be done just moments before that child is born. That is murder in my eyes. This is from the North Carolina Chamber. These are just a small amount of numbers of things that we have done in North Carolina to make our state great. Supported efforts to attract and retain the best teachers. Increasing pay for teachers in their first 10 years in the classroom because Governor McCrory met with superintendents all across the state and they wanted, the first thing they wanted us to do in 2014 was to raise the teachers that have just begun, their first 5-10 year peak teachers. So that's exactly what we did. Because entry-level educators received raises in the 2015 budget, raises contained in the 2016 budget were aimed at mid-level teachers with adjustments and improvements to the entire pay scale. We increased long-term job opportunities for servicemen and women when they are overseas and they've learned how to drive a semi-truck. When they come back here, instead of just not knowing where they can go get a job, they can automatically go get their CDLs and they have got a job with over 4,000 openings for truck drivers right here in North Carolina. We encouraged a common sense solution to prevent energy tax on businesses. As the discussion around the management of coal ash disposal unfolded during 2016, job creators were threatened with a one-size-fits-all remediation plan that could have introduced between $8 billion and $10 billion in unnecessary costs that would have accrued to businesses and consumers in the form of a hidden energy tax. Instead, the passage of House Bill 630, which the North Carolina Chamber strongly backed, established a responsible, common sense solution that will allow affordable closure options for each of 32 coal ash basins statewide. You don't do this overnight, people. You've got to realize that. You don't just close a coal ash basin because you think that's the best way to do it. You've got to think about environmentally. Do you know if you run a tractor through there, that coal ash goes on those tires and it goes right down the road? There's a whole lot more to it than what you think. We advanced in all of the above energy strategies throughout the 2015-16 biennium. We put strong support behind efforts to modernize North Carolina's energy infrastructure. In 2015, we successfully advocated for the state to direct the North Carolina's Utilities Commission to allow Duke Energy to construct a new natural gas power plant to replace older coal-fired burners that were operating at the Asheville Steam and Electric Generating Plant in Buncombe County. Working to pass Senate Bill 673, which provides a path for the creation of low-cost, reliable natural gas infrastructure for a major manufacturing operation with plans to invest at least $200 million and hire a minimum of 1,500 workers. I'm just picking a few off these pages. There's one or two on each page. Modernized taxes. North Carolina Chamber successfully pushed, and we all did, for further tax modernization in 2015 and 16. The new budget measures secured in 2015 lowered the corporate income tax to 4%, dropping to 3% when revenue targets are reached, to keep more money in the private sector, businesses, and your pockets. North Carolina post-reform business tax climate jumped from 44th to 16th in 2015. This is from the Tax Foundation source. We have House Bill 117, the securing fully funded the JDIG Job Development Investment Grant. It's hard to even go all the way from one end of this to the other. The lowest unemployment in 9 years. I'm a small business owner of over 30 years in Yancey County. I own a little picture frame shop, and I enjoy working there a lot. So that's just a very few of the things that we've done. But don't think for a minute that we've not all been busy. What I found out down there is you don't take the credit for anything. You have to give the credit to all the many people that you have to work with daily. And you have, because you have to have their vote. Nothing gets done by one person. You have to have their vote on a bill, whether it's in a committee or whether it's in on the House floor, and then it has to go over to the Senate, and the same thing does over there. It's a very hard job, but I do certainly enjoy it. And thank you very much for having me here this evening.
Jane Hicks will be next, and we'll finish up with Senator Davis after that.
I want to say thank you for having me here. Thank you to the Smoky Mountain News. Thank you to Folk Moved. And thank you to all you folks here for your interest in government and the issues that we're facing. I'm an educator, retired educator. I'm a pediatric nurse practitioner. I'm a former small business owner. And I have a farm. Also, I'm a Christian. Something that folks probably don't know about me, I grew up in rural Mecklenburg County. We had a coal stove for central heat. I wore feed sack dresses and pajamas. Any of you do that? Did you do that? Well into elementary school. And when I was about 6 years old, we converted from an outhouse to an in-house. And we were proud of that. I had a good life. I had a father who worked hard. He had a steady job and he had good health. If any of those factors had been different, my life would have vastly changed. And I was proud of the life that I had. And I've learned that if you've worked hard and you strived for a good life, that was available to you. And in 2010, I noticed something had changed. And those opportunities were not available to our people as they had been once. It looked like the rich were getting richer and the poor were getting poorer. And I thought about that and I thought, you know, that reminds me of sort of what my brother Bill was like. We didn't have dessert very often, but he would say, Jane, look out at that bird in that tree. And I'd be looking, and the next thing I knew, he had taken my strawberry shortcake. And I think the same thing has happened to us. I think the Republicans are busy talking about their G issues, guns, gays, God, gynecology. And now they're talking about going to the bathroom. And everybody has different opinions about those things. Lots of different opinions. But one of the things I know, Republicans and Democrats and the unaffiliated and libertarians all are struggling with the rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer. Now, Jim Davis has given tax breaks to the 1%. Any of you 1% in here? That's the millionaires and billionaires. He's given tax breaks to the special interest groups and to out-of-state corporations. While we've gotten taxes put on us, they're called fees, on our oil changes, on our hunting and fishing license, on our ammo, on our school supplies, for child care, it goes on and on and on. Now, when I was a kid, I was raised on casserole dinners and springtime revivals. And the minister would say to us, you know, one of these days, you're going to meet your maker. And you're going to have to answer some questions. Did you feed the hungry? Or did you take away their food stamps? Did you give drink to the thirsty? Or did you offer them fracked water? Did you welcome the stranger? Or did you build a big wall? Did you clothe the naked? Or did you tax them to the point they couldn't afford a coat? Did you help the sick? Or did you take away their Medicaid opportunities? This is coming directly from the Bible, Matthew chapter 25. And people ask me, why can't we have these things? Why are we struggling? Well, let me tell you what Jim Davis has done. He's given tax breaks to Duke Energy. They've gotten over a $200 million tax break, while he's gotten a campaign contribution. And we, the people, are left to pay for cleaning up the coal ash. Now, when my kids made a mess at home, I told them to clean up their own mess. And also, he's given breaks to out-of-state corporations. Jobs are going here to foreign countries, and those foreigners are coming back to North Carolina so we can train them as to how to do those jobs. And you pay less taxes on a yacht than you do on a mobile home. How many of you people have seen yachts in these mountains? My name is Shane Hitz. I'm from the West, and for the West, I'm for strong education, I'm for strong health care, I'm for having a clean environment. In 1968, I came here. I had already fallen in love with Charles Hips from Haywood County, but I fell in love with these mountains and the people here. And I will stand up for you and fight for you, the hardworking people of our seven western counties. I'm from the West and for the West. Thank you so much, people. God bless you. God bless each and every one of you. Thank you.
Senator Jim Davis, and then we'll move right on to the County Commission candidates debate.
Thank you to all involved at putting on this forum. I appreciate the opportunity to be here, and Scott and Smoky Mountain News, and of course Fulton Moot, and for you for showing up. My name is Jim Davis. I live in Franklin. Moved to Macon County in 1974, right out of dental school. And I'm the son of a career military man, served in World War II in the Navy in the South Pacific, and then he made a career out of the Air Force. I had the great privilege of moving around quite a bit in the world. My father finished seventh grade. My mother graduated from college when she was 62 years old. What our parents taught each of the three of us was education was the key. It was the key for opportunity. And so they pushed and they sacrificed to make sure that each one of their children received an education. And I'm very grateful for that, because that expanded the opportunity. It didn't make us better than anybody, but it gave us a lot of opportunity. And that's what I used to move to Franklin in 1974. It was not my home. I wasn't born there. I came there because I wanted to be there. And I immediately became embedded in the community. I served 10 years as a county commissioner in Macon County from 1996 to 2000 and 2004 to 2010. And I ran for the state senate in 2010 with the burden of getting our physical house in order, because we really had problems in Raleigh in our state. We were doing a lot of things that we couldn't afford. And I'm very proud of the work that we've done since being there. But let me tell you a little bit about my service in Macon County. I led the fight as a conservative Republican on the Macon Board of Commissioners to make sure that we expanded the capital facilities in Macon County that had lied in neglect for many years. We set apart a 15-year plan to address the capital facilities program, and we have just completed that plan, an expenditure of over $100 million in capital facilities in Macon County. We went from 35 mobile units to zero. And I was honored to work with fellow commissioners and with the school board in order to address that. And not one of those years did I ever vote to cut education spending. And the same can be said for my service in the North Carolina Senate. Not once have I voted to cut education funding. The facts speak for themselves. In spite of the myth that's prevalent among a lot of people that we have cut education spending, you would notice that most of those facts go back to 2008, before we ever got there. We got there in 2011. And since that time, we've increased education funding by over $1.7 billion. Over $1.1 billion in inflation-adjusted dollars. I was very proud to help get passed in the Senate the $2 billion education bond, to put it before the people, to see if the people wanted to invest that money in education, and about $998 million went to the university system, about $300 and some million went to the community college. Other money went for grant and loan funding for water and sewer projects, in addition to the zoo and the parks. I think that money will be wisely invested in our state. And I'm glad it passed. It passed with a majority of Republican and Democrat voters who went to the polls. And the great beneficiary of that, the education part of that bond, would be Western Carolina University, where they're going to have $110 million spent on a new science building, a building that's long overdue and well deserved. In addition to that, Southwestern Community College gets a little over $7 million. In addition to Tri-County Community College, I think gets about $4.5 million, and Haywood a little over $3 million. And so I was very proud when I heard that we were going to have this $2 billion bond if the community colleges were going to be involved. And I polled each one of the presidents of the community college to give me their top three priorities for education funding on their campus. And each of them obliged, and we got those funded in the education bond. Let me tell you a little bit about our reform, our tax reform that we've done. We now have the lowest tax rate in the Southeast. We have the lowest income tax rate in the Southeast for all states that have a state income tax. That would, of course, exclude Florida. We have a sales tax rate that's continually to decrease. It is true that we've expanded the base, a tax policy that's long overdue that needs to adjust to the new economy. And yes, we have raised some fees. Fees haven't been raised since the 90s. And it's our goal to ensure that the fees pay for the service. We do not think that the general fund revenue should supplant that money. We think that the fees should cover the service, and that's why we've adjusted those. And that impacts everybody. The nice thing about a consumption tax as we go towards that is that it captures the underground economy. Tourists pay into it, and everybody has some skin in the game. And so I think that's good. Well, what does that happen? That tax reform and regulatory reform. Just today, we got from the Office of State Budget and Management, our revenues have exceeded our projections for the first quarter of this year by $158 million. Exceeded our projections by $158 million. That's just the first quarter. What does that mean to you? It means that we have more money to invest, not spend, invest in the legitimate functions of government. Public education being number one, it's 56% of our budget. K-12 is 37%. In addition to that, we have public safety and public health are the bigger things that we have to deal with. Some questions have been given about Medicaid reform. It is true that North Carolina has not voted to expand Medicaid yet, and I don't know that we will on the horizon. In case you've been watching the news, the Affordable Care Act is imploding under its own weight. It's not sustainable. And for us to expand Medicaid, especially when we had a Medicaid problem in North Carolina where expenditures were about $450 million the year that we took over, beyond projections, $450 million, a hole that we had to fill. It's very foolish to build a house on a poor foundation. And so we are just this year, we got a handle on Medicaid expenditures. And so we're about $25 million to the good, I think, on Medicaid. And so our projections are running really good because of the reforms that we have done. And one of the things about expanding Medicaid is the government has promised that they're going to pay 90% of it. You know, 100% for the first year, after that 90% funding. We don't know what that 10% of it is. In addition to that, this year, the federal government is running a $600 billion budget deficit. $600 billion that we're spending, money that we don't have. We don't know how long that's going to happen. And so for us to expand any program with the hope and a prayer that we're going to get money from the federal government is very foolish, in my opinion. I'm very glad and proud of all the changes that we've done. Our economic environment is better than any other state in the Southeast. Our poverty rate has dropped down 3%. Poverty rate. You're talking about, you know, jobs are the best things for curing poverty. Our jobs have increased since January 2011, 411,000. $411,000 more in North Carolina. Why is that? We think it has a lot to do with the regulatory and the tax changes that we've made in North Carolina. Businesses are coming here. Every major business magazine ranks North Carolina in the top five in the country. And we're seeing the benefits of that. And again, more people working, more people contributing to the economy, fewer people collecting welfare and unemployment. That's all a good thing, because we want all North Carolinians to be productive citizens, to be as productive as they can possibly be. So I'm very proud to the record that we have, and we have had some real challenges. I've had to vote on something that I had no idea that I would ever have to vote on, and that's to keep men out of women's bathrooms when I went to Raleigh. But you need to know that HB 2 was a response to an unconstitutional ordinance passed by the Charlotte Town Council. It was unconstitutional. Our Attorney General refused to stop it, and so we had to step in, call a special session, and say that's not going to happen under our watch. HB 2 was never, is not now, and never was about discrimination against any community, including LGBTQ community. It was about ensuring that gender identity and gender expression was not a fluid thing. If you can decide what sex you are from any one day to another, just think of the impact that has for everything in North Carolina. It's a real problem. That's problematic as far as I'm concerned. And so I was very proud to vote on HB 2. Could it be changed? There's no such thing as perfect legislation. And could it be revised in the future to make it better? I'm sure it could, just like a lot of other things. But I think individuals' personal privacy is far more important than catering to a small segment of the population. I don't think they should be given special rights to the exclusion of everybody else. I think we need to accommodate everybody. I'm offering being inclusive, and I think people should be able to live their own lives, but not at the expense of everybody else. My name is Jim Davis. I've been your senator since 2011. I'm very proud of the job that I've done, and I'm very responsible to constituent service, and we've added over 3,000 jobs in the western part of the state just for Evergreen and the Eastern Band, and I'm proud to be a part of that as well. So if you like what we've been doing, I'm going to continue to do that. It's an honor to serve. My name is Jim Davis. If you want to know any of the awards, my philosophy, my committee assignments and chairmanships, you can go to davisforncsenate.com. It's all there. Thank you very much. God bless America. God bless North Carolina. God bless you.
Senator Jim Davis, thank you. And thank you to all the candidates who have spoken this far. I'm going to go ahead and bring the county commissioners up and get this thing rolling.
That's all I'm going out. I understand. Sorry. I apologize for your communication. I'm going to be on the track.
Sorry about this.
Can you do it back there?
Again, want to thank all the candidates that came and joined us earlier tonight. Scott McLeod, our publisher, said earlier, my name is Corey Valancourt. I'm a reporter for the Smoky Mountain News. We're pleased to have all of the Haywood County Commissioner candidates here tonight. Just a little housekeeping right up the front. I'm going to tell you how this is going to work. Again, thanks everyone for coming, everyone who's watching at home on YouTube and on Facebook. Questions will be given in this order each time. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer a question. After every candidate has had their chance to answer a question, at my discretion, I may direct follow-ups or allow rebuttals. So if everyone's answered the question and you'd like to rebut something another candidate said, be sure to let me know. As you see down here at the front, our lovely and talented news editor, Jesse Stone, will be serving as timekeeper tonight. Let's have a hand for Jesse. Each candidate has 2 minutes to answer the question. When there are 30 seconds remaining in your allotted time, you will see Jesse hold up the yellowish-looking card. And when your time has expired, she will hold up the reddish-looking card. If you would please observe those, we will keep this thing rolling at an appropriate pace and all get out of here at a decent hour. Is everybody ready? Okay. Here's our first question of the night, and it will probably be one of the more fun questions of the night. It's a two-part question. Since this is a partisan race, how would you describe your relations with the local county party, and do you support your party's nominee for president? Mrs. Black.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome everybody here and thank you for coming. As far as other party relations, I think I get along well with other parties and people within my party. I spent all day with Mr. Rogers and Mr. Inslee at the Senior Center today. Nobody broke out in arms or fighting or anything, so I think we all did pretty well. Haywood County is too small for us to be divided. It doesn't matter if you're Democrat, Republican, black, white, red, green, little blue men, it doesn't matter. We need to work together for the betterment of our county.
Mr. Brown.
I thought you were going to open with a 2-minute opening, so I have to be prepared to answer your question. I'm ready to do that. My name is Steve Brown. Thank you all for being here tonight. And the question was about your affiliation with the party. I have been a Democrat since I was turned 18 years old. Back in the day when I grew up, if you were not registered Democrat, you didn't get to vote in local elections, so you had no choice. These other three gentlemen that are sitting, and two gentlemen and a lady that are sitting here tonight, know about me and my involvement in this community. It's true what Robin said. It's not whether you're a Democrat, whether you're a Republican, whether you're white, whether you're black, whether you're a male or you're female. In order for this county to be successful, we've all got to work together. I've spent the last 40 years of my life working in numerous nonprofits with my church, community organizations, with the school system, with representatives from the legislature, and that's what it takes to be a successful commissioner in Haywood County. And I'm proud to be a Democrat, and I do ask for your vote starting today.
Okay. Mr.
Edson.
Repeat the question.
Since this is a partisan race, how would you describe your relations with your local county party, and do you support your party's nominee for president?
Okay, because I didn't think that second question was anybody.
Yeah, that's true.
We'll come back to those.
Okay. Well, I've been a Republican. I ran as a Republican in 2000. I ran as a Republican in 2002, in 2006, in 2008, 2012, and 2016. So I think I've known a lot of the people in my party over the years, and I've generally had their support. Right now, I don't think I have a lot of support of the local party, but I'm running as a Republican. I'm more of a Republican nationally. And I don't think, as far as local goes, the local party can help candidates get elected. And I think they do a good job doing that. They do the palm cards, and that's a good thing to do to let people know who their candidates are, especially the judges and the school board, if you're a partisan and you want to vote that race. I am, as far as the president goes, I am supporting Donald Trump. I am a pro-life voter. And Donald Trump last night said he was pro-life. I've heard him say he was pro-choice, but he said he was pro-life. Hillary Clinton will never be pro-life. And I'm pro-life. I'm proud to be pro-life. My wife and I have had 6 children. 2 of my children have passed away, and they're with the Lord. And I believe life is very important. And I think nationally, and I will not vote for a pro-choice candidate. I think life is, that tells a lot about a person, if you're pro-life. And that's just the way I feel when I vote for a national office. And so I'm supporting my party's nominee because of that reason, and because of the Supreme Court nomination process.
Thank you, Commissioner Inslee. Mr. Rogers.
Yes, hello. Thank you. My name is Brandon Rogers. I am a candidate for Haywood County Commissioner, and I would like to answer the question by saying, yeah, I feel that I am a people person. I feel like it's one of my strengths. I can get along with many people. Even though we mention all the colors, we do have a brown and a black down here. And
She has some green, too.
She does have some green also.
So this is colorful.
As far as the colors, I can work with anybody. I feel like I can get along with anybody. Again, like I said, that's one of my strengths. I feel like that's what's helped me in my small business. I feel like that's what helped me when I was a production manager at Day International over in Arden. I had to work with many folks over there, from the technology group to HR, all the way through. Always got along with people, and I'm a team player. To answer the question about the president, I am supporting Donald Trump. He is our party's nominee. Our beliefs line up, our moral issues line up, and he is our party's nominee, and that's why I'm supporting.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers. Mrs. Black,
yes.
Do you support your party's nominee for president?
Yes, I do. I support my party's nominee.
And Mr. Brown?
Yes, I do.
Fantastic.
Sorry, I missed that one.
Yeah, me too.
Let's go on to the second question here. Recently, the county executed an interlocal agreement with the town of Canton, whereby the county contributed about $200,000 to Canton's $43,000 to help bolster the infrastructure of the new Western Carolina Freightliner location that's off exit 31 on Interstate 40. What kind of appetite do you have for these kinds of economic incentives?
I think it was a great plan. In fact, early on, before it got to the town of Canton and county commissioner level, I was part of that conversation, hooking up a few parties. The owner, one of the owners is my client. I'll just say that now. And she told me I could talk about this, so I'm not breaking any confidentiality. All I did was make a few phone calls and hooked up a few people in the right places. That building that's been sitting there, wasting away because the half-life of vacant real estate is almost nothing, with knee-high grass, is now going to be occupied, fixed up. It's going to bring jobs to Haywood County. And I'm proud of it. I think that's exactly what we need to be doing, investing in our infrastructure and bringing jobs.
Mr. Brown?
I also am in agreement with, I know, Mr. Inslee and the other commissioners and probably the other two candidates, but I wholeheartedly support the agreement that was struck between the commissioners and the town of Canton, and providing the $200,000 for incentives to help Freightliner establish a business in there that will employ between 25 and 35 people during the first year, and hopefully it will be up to as many as 60 within the first 5 years. Another important part of that was done by our commissioner to the left was that as part of that they worked with bringing sewer and water and working on the infrastructure to bring that to that facility, which I'm sure you'll ask about later, which brings up about talking about enterprise zones, which is another form of land use planning, which I also think is very important to this county. And I think that by doing this and adding these the sewer and water and being able to facilitate this project is a win-win for every resident of Haywood County.
Commissioner?
Okay, I did vote for that. And because the way that you need to look at incentives, they can be a bad thing, and sometimes they can be, but you gotta have to look at what the results will be. And it's an investment for the county. It'll be invested. And what we're investing in is expanding the infrastructure, which is water and sewer, and the road. The main thing was the road that we helped them with to get up to that site. And by improving that road, it also helps get to a couple of other sites in that area that we hope will get developed later on. It expands their water and sewer. We also have, as Steve said, good paying jobs. Those jobs pay. My son's a diesel mechanic. He works in Asheville. He makes a very good wage. I don't want to say what it is, but it's probably double what the county average is. So those are very good paying jobs. And also the sales, you've got to look at, you're going to get your money back as a county. It's just a short-term sacrifice, but it's a long-term gain. It's going to expand our tax base because that was a vacant piece of property, not really doing a whole lot. And now they're going to add buildings. They're going to be selling trucks there. The transfer trucks, or I don't know what they call the big rigs, but they'll be selling those. We'll be getting the tax, sales tax revenue from that. So I think we looked at probably a less than 10-year payback just from the expansion of the site for property taxes, as well as our sales tax base that we'll be getting. So Haywood County will win, and it's just an investment. All of us make investments. We may make investments in, I buy a lot of real estate. I make an investment, and I hold it for a few years, I improve it maybe, and then I sell it, and I make a profit. And the county, you have to look at investments in, like this when you're doing county incentives. Try not to look at it in a bad way, but try to look at the positives. And I think this is a, this has very many more positives than negatives.
Thank you. Mr. Rogers.
Yes, thank you. I would say as long as we can afford it, we ought to do stuff like that. I think we'd all agree that one of our top issues here in the county is jobs. Our economic situation is not where any of us would like for it to be. So anytime we can give an incentive to a business, I'm all for it. I'm even for looking at other businesses that we have here in the county and awarding them when they're doing good, and also giving incentives to attract new businesses. One of the big things that's on my top list here is, like I said, our economic situation and trying to bring jobs in, whether that's big plants or small businesses. Either way, as long as we bring the jobs in, that's going to help a lot of our top issues, I believe. So, yes, I am supportive.
Quick follow-up question. We'll stick with Mr. Rogers here. You said you support these types of incentives if we can afford them. Commissioner Ensley can probably back me up on this. I think we said the payback on this project for the county was 5 to 7 years in that neighborhood.
Well, yeah, 10 came to mind, but there's so many numbers all the time. That probably sounds about right.
All right, so let's say it's 5 to 7 years. Mr. Rogers, if that was 15 to 17 years, do you think that would be something you would support? And I'm going to ask everyone the same question coming back.
Well, 15 to 17 is a little drawn out, I think. You know, if it is around the 10-year mark, I think I would be more for it. Any business that you have, I have to do this in my own small business, you've got to look at the payback. I just put some LED lights in my business, and the payback on that's going to be 2.5 years. And anytime you're spending money, you got to look at the long-term effect. To draw that out over a 17-year period is a little bit too long. I would like to hold that to a minimum, and 10 to 12 would probably be the max.
Commissioner Ensley, you agree with that?
That's a good guess, I will. That's a good question. You have to look at each situation separately and see, because of the economy, what type of jobs they are that may be coming. Because if it's good paying, you're not going to always need a diesel mechanic, okay? And so they're locating their shop there. And that's a pretty large, Freightliner is a large company. They're moving from Asheville to Haywood County, and I love getting things from Buncombe County. So that was one reason, too, we're getting some jobs from Buncombe County. Gosh, there was one more thought I had, I should have wrote it down, but I would support that.
Mr. Brown?
Yes, you're asking a question in the timeline of 5 to 10 years. In 17 years, I hope to be alive. That is a difficult decision to talk about the payback, but obviously if it's going to be brought back through sales tax and through the property tax to repay the investment that the county commissioners have committed to, I'm all in favor of doing that. And I would be a little more leery if it went up to as long as 17 years, but it is important that we bring small business back to Haywood County. We need to strengthen the EDC by providing more funding from them to attract these types of businesses to Haywood County. We also need to work with the Chamber and the TDA and other groups to try to get them to add additional jobs and creation in this in Haywood County. So I definitely think that the payback from the property tax and the sales tax and the great work that they did, building the infrastructure, as he said, to build that road, which will open up additional property, which is a part of that equation. If you open up additional property, new businesses or new factories are built there, then that is also going to allow you to collect property taxes and possibly sales tax, which could bring that number back from 17 years, maybe back to 10 years if that additional land is developed.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Mrs. Black?
Absolutely not.
You think that's too much?
Absolutely.
That's too long. Is there a number or a line somewhere where you would say too long?
Never over 15 years. I prefer it to be, I'd prefer it to be 10, because nobody knows what's going to be going on 15 years from now. A little bit far out to speculate. So if it was over 15 years, I would not support it.
Great. Moving on to the next question. Mr. Brown alluded to this just a little while ago. There seem to be two schools of thought on comprehensive countywide planning, either issuing a comprehensive countywide plan or handling these situations as they arise. Where do you fall on the spectrum, Mrs. Black, and why?
Is the question about zoning? Is that what you're asking us? Okay. I'd like to share two stories with you tonight. Two neighboring counties, different counties. An old gentleman had a family property, been in his family for years. They wanted to put a commercial plant beside him. He didn't fight it. He knew it was good for the county. He knew it was good for jobs. Let him go ahead and put in their commercial property. As he aged, he needed his daughter to move back. She wanted to move on her family land, build a home, and take care of her father. She can't. It's commercial. He can't split it, and his daughter can't move back there on family land to take care of him. That's one issue I have. The second issue is another small business out in rural Transylvania County. Maybe Henderson. And the guy has a store, like Ferguson's store, down on Fine Street. Sells a few little supplies, has a coffee shop, you know, soda shop. Have a little bluegrass music on Saturday night. He had to close because it's now rural. So those people are driving 10 miles just to get a gallon of milk. I believe we can handle our problems with ordinances. I do not think our county, you can drive 2 miles and be downtown or completely out in farmland. Widespread zoning, I just don't see how it's going to work here.
Thank you, Mrs. Black. Mr. Brown?
I think we need to start by differentiating what you're talking about zoning and about land use planning. I do support land use planning. There was a study done, as Kevin's well aware, back. It was done by Western Carolina University that asked the residents of Haywood County if they were in support of some type of land use planning. Overwhelmingly, I believe it was well over 60%.
Two-thirds
supported some type of land use planning. And in fact, they have gone through the first step of that of passing an ordinance, which is called the High Impact Development Ordinance, which many of y'all are aware of. It was voted unanimously by the commissioners, which protects the vulnerable populations such as schools, child care, assisted living hospitals, and other things like chemical facilities, asphalt plants, whatever, quarries, thank you, and landfills. And I think that was passed unanimously. There was no comments. I think it has been a very successful thing. I think we need to continue to look at other options for land use planning. The second one, which I mentioned earlier, was enterprise zones, which would be particular the new Freightliner location is building there, that we may want to look at particular areas in the county that would be specific for a certain type of business, a certain type, maybe be farmland, or whether it be residential or commercial, and look at those areas in the county and try to set up enterprise zones where those areas will be protected, say for example Freightliner, which would allow businesses and other businesses locate there, where would we be able to allow them to do that, not use the land for some other purpose.
Commissioner?
Okay, and we did that study. I knew that study happened because I think they called 8,000 people. And I know they did because they called me, and they called Mark. I think Mark Swunger got a call also. So I know that this study was pretty large and in-depth. But two-thirds wanted some type of planning, but we weren't real specific. We did pass two ordinances this year on to protect property, and it basically protected people's values as well as their health, you know, in schools and their nursing facilities by passing the high-tech or high-impact study. And I think that shows that I was, and the other board, we were receptive to the concerns of the public. They came in, they wanted this done, and we were able to get this accomplished. I think my background as a land surveyor helps with this and land planning. I know we, when I first ran as a commissioner, I felt like the commissioners were making decisions on land use policies, and they didn't really understand the county. I've been all over the county. I bet I've walked every cove in this county. And they're all, it's so unique. You go from the rolling land in Canton and Bethel and Iron Duck up to the steep mountains where the parks are and the national forests are, and the mountains are just so diverse and different. And you just can't go in with one big plan and just say that's what we're going to do, because the terrain is so different. There's some areas that will never have a commercial facility on it. It's impossible. But I think we need to be receptive of what we can do. And when you do have water and sewer connections, you need to be careful, because you do, and set up enterprise zones, because you do have, you can do a lot more detrimental things with that. And so I would be in favor of having conditions of, if you connect to water and sewer, then you're going to have some restrictions, but there's going to be some conditions. And it needs to be community-based. We need to listen to the community and see what their needs are before we pass anything and make sure that we're taking care of everybody.
Mr. Rogers?
Yeah, initially, I'm against it. I believe that if you own your property, you should be able to do whatever you want. But then on the other hand, there, I know there is some situations where it's needed. You know, as I talk to people out in the community, I hear this a lot. You know, everybody's against it initially until you mention some certain issues that could arise, and then they're, well, maybe I don't want that beside my house. So I feel like there is times that it is needed. I think the piecemeal approach is probably the best, where you take each issue and look at it separately. I don't think, you know, having a whole zoning or a whole planning would be good. So I think the piecemeal approach would be good. You know, too many times I feel that we get ruled and regulated and zoned to death, and I would like to hold that to a minimum.
Thank you. Mrs. Black, Canton's taxpayers fund the town's municipal pool, despite the fact that it's used mostly by non-residents. Likewise, Waynesville's rec center is funded by the town's taxpayers, but non-residents pay the same fees as residents to use it. Would you advocate contributing county resources to support municipal recreation projects that benefit the entire county?
I support any advancement in tourism and recreational activities. In a recent survey by Haywood County residents, the number two concern was a lack of recreational opportunities. Recreation can be used as an economic development. Just in this year alone, we have tourism was up 14%, providing $1.2 million in occupancy tax to Haywood County. According to the U.S. Travel Association, the economic impact in 2015 to the state of North Carolina is $167 million, generating 1,700 jobs, $6 million in taxes alone for Haywood County. I was up at Rendezvous for a speech earlier in the year, and I went outside. I was nervous, so I went outside to get some air, and they have these pamphlets out in front, and I picked up probably a dozen, a couple of zip lines, a couple of horseback rides, a couple, there was even an arts and a craft, and even a theater. There was rafting, and I held them up in front of the whole crowd, and I said, you know what all this has in common? And nobody knew. Not a one of them were in Haywood County. Now, we're at a Haywood County hotel off of I-40, and we're sending everybody out of the county to spend their tax dollars. So I do think we need to go back and revisit the occupancy tax. I'm not for raising taxes, but the other towns asked for that, and we need to support the other boards in this county. But at any rate, yes, I do support increasing recreational opportunities, not just at the rec park and pool. We've got Camp Hope up there that's a mile from the parkway. If we could somehow get a trail across that property that's for sale right now, we could bring all those hikers from the parkway into Haywood County. We could open up a camp store. We could get that campground back open. We've got the Rough Creek Watershed. It's already got a road. It just needs repair. We can do a lot with mountain biking and the number one requested activity, which is hiking.
Thank you. Mr. Brown?
I agree that I believe recreation is one of the top platforms that I've had as far as developing jobs and increasing jobs in Haywood County. And as Robin mentioned, one of the first things we need to do, and then I'll come back to the answer to the question, is that she mentioned it, is that every town leader, the Chamber of Commerce and the TDA and the county commissioners unanimously supported adding 2% to the TDA tax, which taxes only people that stay in motels, hotels, bed and breakfasts and stuff in Haywood County, and it was defeated in the legislature. The first thing we need to do, and when I become commissioner, I would like to work with these county leaders to reintroduce this legislation to add 2% to the TDA room tax, which would not cause anyone in this room to pay an additional tax, but yet the money was proposed to be used for building recreation facilities for Haywood County, and also possibly to construct attractions for people outside of the county to be able to come into the county and use. The town of Canton and the town of Waynesville, or the town of Waynesville does have a wonderful facility, and the town of Canton also is getting ready, we hope, if the funds finally come through. I would have to study the structure, right, because I'm not 100% sure But it is probably my opinion that if people live outside the county, they probably ought to pay a higher rate to use the town of Waynesville pool. And probably if they live outside the town of Kent, that there ought to be a small, maybe minimal increase for those residents.
Commissioner?
I would, as far as recreation for the town of Waynesville and Canton, I do know, I didn't realize this, but Canton, I was talking with some Canton officials the other day, and they said that the people that use the Canton pool are mostly county residents. And I didn't know that. And I think we need, as county commissioners, we probably need to be educated on just how many residents use the Waynesville and Canton facilities, and probably start trying to carve out some funding in our budget every year to help them out with that. I know Canton's trying to rebuild their pool. It's the only outside pool in Haywood County, probably in our area. And it's a very good, you know, we want our kids to do things, and that's what we've got to do. But it does take money. And as far as the occupancy tax, I was in favor of that because it's paid by non-Haywood County residents. These are people that come from Florida or wherever and stay in our motels. And we're looking at going up 2%, which would be $2 if it's a $100 room a night, for us to use that funding. And once we get that funding, then we will have people compete for the projects. And competition always produces good projects. Everybody kept saying, we don't know what projects we're going to build. No, because people are going to compete for them on what that project is and how it can be funded. And I think that's a good way. You know, we're not paying for it. You know, the people coming in here, they're putting pressure on our infrastructure, such as our EMS. When we have holidays, our EMS are busy, and we're not getting any funding. We're having to send them out to help these people. They're in accidents and everything else that comes with a large influx. So they're putting pressure on our services, and we're not getting anything in return. Buncombe County got this tax last year or a couple of years ago, and as usual, they're kicking our behinds again. So Buncombe County got it, and of course we can't get it, and I don't understand why. And like I say, we can compete for that. And I do know some of the areas we can, other areas, there are conservation easements going in Maggie Valley, which we can do hiking and biking trails, and we're gonna have to have funding to help with those trails, and occupancy tax can do that.
Thank you. Mr. Rogers.
Yes, I would be in support of it. I mean, as Kevin was saying, you look across the state line in Pigeon Forge and Gatlinburg, and they're doing this very thing. You know, they're using the visitors' money that's coming in, and it's helping with stuff like this. I was just looking at some notes. There was $168 million that was spent here in 2015. And you look at surrounding County Swain, for example, there was 256, and even Buncombe was 729. I don't have the figures for what Tennessee has for like Pigeon Forge, but I can only imagine what that would be. And yeah, anytime we got folks coming from outside of Haywood County bringing money in, I'll take every bit of it.
Well, this question seemed to kind of devolve into that 2% tax thing. Mr. Rogers, would you advocate contributing county resources, the 2% notwithstanding, to benefit such recreation projects?
Yes, I would.
Absolutely. And Mrs. Black, I don't think that 2% question was something I was going to ask later, but you guys have already answered it. I don't think Mrs. Black had a chance. Do you support that 2%
tax? I said I did.
You did? Okay, great. Next question. Teacher supplement pay. It's come under scrutiny recently. In fact, Rebecca Benhart, a school board candidate who stood here about 45 minutes ago, said she wanted to raise it to 10% since it's looked at as non-competitive with our neighbors. Do you support raising teacher supplement pay? Why or why not?
First, I want to thank our Haywood County School System for the excellent job they did. They are 11th, as someone else said. That's in the top 10%. And that's something we need to publicize because business looks at that. They want to know if your school systems are good. In fact, they want to know which schools in that system are best. I do support education. I would like to look at the spending formula. I said we needed to tweak it, and a couple people said that it's been tweaked maybe in the wrong direction, because per capita expense for education is down 13% at the county level from 2011 to 2015. In 2011, expenditures were $22.2 million, and in 2015, they were $19.6 million. Right now, today, in Haywood County, 55% of the school children in Haywood County are on reduced or free lunch. That is up 30% from 2008, or a 50% increase. Somebody said earlier our poverty rate's going down. I'm not seeing it here. I guess maybe it's different somewhere else where I've not been. I do support education. We do fund it well for Haywood County, but I think we can do better. I think it's a changing of priorities from some of the things that money's being spent on now to what it should be spent on.
Mr. Bryant.
That's a great question, because I spent 15 years of my life working in the Haywood County Schools, running the Haywood County Schools Foundation, and I lived that problem and heard from the teachers and the principals and the different people in that school every day that we were being, that teachers in Buncombe County and surrounding counties were paying a much higher supplement than we were in Haywood County. And Haywood County and the commissioner stepped up to the plate and brought it up to, I believe it's a little over 5% right now. And it started out when I was in the school system at a little over 2%. Can we do better with the supplement for the Haywood County Schools? I think there's always that opportunity. And I know that Bill Upton and I believe it's Kirk Kirkpatrick have agreed to serve on a task force, which is made up of school personnel and administrators, to look at a possible way of trying to come up with a formula that might add additional funds to be able to provide an additional supplement to the teachers and the faculty in Haywood County Schools. But I will tell you that the Haywood County Commissioners have a tough job to do. I know that one of the candidates mentioned she would like to raise it to 10%, but in order to do that, currently Kevin Inslee and the other commissioners have to make that decision. So we've got to make sure that we're covering all of the different areas in the county, all of the different public services that we provide, to try to make sure that we cover all of those expenses first. But as you know, I'm absolutely, my top priority has always been is to support education, public education in the Haywood County Schools. And I will do my best to try to find a way to let the teachers and the faculty in Haywood County Schools compete with Buncombe County. I think we lost, I don't know, it was 15 or 18 teachers this year to different counties, because they can go to Buncombe County and make almost $10,000 more for doing the same job. So we as a community have to step up and understand the value of public education, and we need to make sure that we do everything we can to help the public school system. We currently are 24th, I believe, in the state in funding for the Haywood County Schools. Can we do better? Yes, we possibly can, but it will take a team effort between all of the members of the school system, the commissioners, you people sitting in this audience, to try to find ways to make our children have the best education possible for them to move on and live in this community and come back and have a career in this county.
Commissioner Enzi?
Yeah, I would like to wait for the study committee's results to find out what they find. But of course, I have supported educational funding every year. As Senator Davis was saying, as a commissioner, he supported it every year. I have supported it every year. And we also have, as Steve said, Steve pretty much stole my thunder. So, but he was right about, you know, there's commissioners on the committee, and if there's a consensus to move forward, then we will from the committee. And I would favor increasing it incrementally. We can't do it all at once, but I think we can probably do it incrementally with a pay raise. Each year, when we do our budget, we usually have an increase. It's usually a small increase, but we do have an increase. And we need to look at that increase, see what the dollars are, and start, if there's a consensus among the commissioners in the committee, once the committee gets the results and we have that, you know, then we can make that a priority. If that's, you know, we always have our priorities. I know last year, a year before last, we told Ira we want education in the schools and the community college to be increased, and it was. And we were trying to meet what they asked for. And so teacher supplements, we need to look at it. Counties is 5%, Buncombe County's is 16%. I believe I heard that, which is a lot. I want to see what Macon County's supplement is, Jackson County supplement is, and Madison County supplement is. We're a little bit bigger than they are, but we're not near as big as Buncombe County. And Buncombe County can afford a lot more. If I was a teacher, I don't think I'd want to drive to Asheville every day. For $10,000 more, I might would, but I don't think I want to if it's not that much. So we need to try to do this incrementally and to have a plan to do it. I think the main thing is getting on a plan and then sticking to that plan and try to increase it, which is what we did to get it to 5%. Before it was, like Steve said, 2%. Through his efforts and the other commissioners, we were able to get it to where it is now today.
Mr. Rogers.
Yeah, I think one thing we'd all agree on again is how important education is. Education is very important to me, as I think Robin said earlier. We were ranked 11th out of 115 here in our district, which I think is great. Big supporter of our education, our schools, and of course our teachers. You know, the way I look at this is we've got to do it like I would do in my own business or you're doing any business. You got to look at the turnover rate. As I've talked to many principals and teachers here in the county, they're telling me how big the turnover is. And what you got to look at is the retraining process and what that's costing the county as well. So when you look at that, just as you would any other payback or any other thing, you got to look at that and say, well, yeah, we would support it or we wouldn't support it. Another thing I'd like to do is our lottery funding. I know that we were promised earlier on we would be getting some money from our lottery, and I would like to use the relationships that I will have and that I currently have to see where this funding is going so that it could possibly help in an increase. But I want to do whatever we can, whatever's possible, to keep and retain our teachers here in the community. I think it's important, and I would support it.
Moving on, Mrs. Black, do you support the price tag for the $3.5 million or $3.75 million, depending who you believe, animal shelter? And if not, where would you have spent that money, or would you have spent it at all?
I came out early on and I said I didn't think we needed to spend $4 million on an animal shelter. I'm not calling it a doghouse or a dog pound because I know we needed a new shelter. I just do not think that we need a $3 or $4 million animal shelter. We have other needs in this county. We're talking about a lot of them tonight. The $2 that's going on everybody's tax bill, I would much prefer a dollar of that to be for the animal shelter and a dollar of that to be for broadband. Did everybody hear that?
What was that again?
Okay, I have animals. I have a farm, just like Jane Hip said. They're not my pets, they're my family. I live with a 100-pound white German Shepherd that has a bed at the foot of my bed. On Sunday morning, she gets up and snuggles in the bed. She's family. I adopted a stray cat because people keep dropping them off at my barn on a regular basis. Last week, cutest little thing, solid black, beautiful green eyes. We call him Vader, Dark Vader. I don't begrudge animals. I think what we need to do in this county, one thing, is to make stronger penalties for people that abuse animals.
Amen.
I think we need to look at no chain law. There is no reason a dog should be on a chain 24/7. That's what I think we can do for the animals in Haywood County.
Mr. Brown.
I obviously agree about the no chain law and the no leash laws and raising the penalties for animals that are abused or gone through cruelty in this community. Early on in this project, this has been a very difficult decision for me to talk about the building of the animal shelter. I thought about it originally and I was very concerned about the tag price that originally started out at, I believe, $3.2 or $3.3 million. And it's now, I think, gone up to close to 3.8 with the construction site. And originally, I felt like there might be a cheaper way in order to build this facility. I attended the forum and attended the county commissioners' meetings when there was a presentation made by the experts that they brought in from all over the country to talk about what type of facility Haywood County does need. I feel like the commissioners did due diligence in trying to research and do the study for that. Actually, early on, I was asked by the friends of the animal shelter to come and talk to them about how they could raise money to support this project. As many of y'all know, in my last 15 years, fundraising and grant writing has been a part of what I've done. And I sat down with them and asked them what their goal was and what they would like to accomplish. And they felt comfortable that they could raise well over $1 million. And as you know, the county commissioners have approved this project and approved it to go forward with it. I feel very confident that this group of the Friends of the Animal Shelter will raise $1 million, and I feel confident they may raise more for that. And due to that fact, I would, if I had been in his seat, I would have voted to support building the animal shelter in Haywood County.
Commissioner Ensley, there was perhaps no bigger advocate of the animal shelter during that process than you. Do you still feel the same that you did when you made that vote?
Yes, it was identified before 2002 to be replaced. The animal shelter is almost 30 years old. If anybody's been there, it's decrepit, it's loud, it's It's disease prone. So we did a study. I did a study. I was like, why does this cost us so much? And I studied 20 animal shelters across the nation. And I lined them up, saw what the cost was. It was between $300 and $400 square foot, which is, we did, that's where we landed. Jackson County was looking to build an animal shelter. It's between $5.4 and $6.2 million. They found out it was going to be very expensive. They hired an architect that did shelters for between $2 and $4 million, which is exactly where we fell. So we had our experts develop a plan. I want to make sure when we build this shelter that it's there to last, that it's a good service for the county residents for decades to come. We were able to get a low-interest loan at 2.75%. USDA said that was the lowest that she had ever seen a loan, an interest. And that's what we got it for. It's going to cost each resident in Haywood County $2.30 a year to service this debt. $2.30 a year to service the debt. So my wife and I have dogs. We pay, I think I figured we generate about $50 a year in sales tax from our dogs, from buying dog food. That don't count the other things we buy, food for our cat. So a little bit of that money is going to go back to an animal shelter, and I think that's appropriate. Before that, let's just face it, we were killing animals, people. We were killing them. We had, in the week that I voted for that, I know of 2 days, the veterinarian put down 9 animals. She killed them. And so they've taken to the landfill like they were several years ago. The pit was full when I visited the landfill in 2002. You know, Proverbs 12:10 says, a righteous man regards the life of his animal. And I think it's biblical to take care of our animals and do it in a proper way, in a cost-effective way. And I believe we have. We've done the study, and I believe that was it was an appropriate decision.
Mr. Rutherford.
Let me tell you guys a little story. When I was happily married, me and my wife, of course, had our 3 kids. We had all 3 of them at home. They're two years apart between the 3 of them. I think my daughter was 6. The middle one was 4, and the smallest one was 2. Also had 2 dogs, 2 large dogs, which were 2 yellow labs, a small dog, and we all slept in the same bed. And I'm not kidding. If you don't believe me, you can ask my wife. Most nights I would end up on the floor just so I could get a few minutes of sleep. But I say that to say that I do love animals. I love them, think we need to take care of them. And if you go up to our animal shelter that we currently have, you'll see that we definitely need a new one. However, I would not have supported spending the amount of money that we did. I think the amount of money that we did, I think the question you ask is how else would we have spent the money? And one way I would like to spend some of the money is the homeless kids that we have here in the county. I think affordable housing is a big issue that we have. Just some stats here. There's a 3-year waiting list right now for Mountain Projects Housing, and there's 700 people that I last got reported that's on a waiting list, and only 35 of those get a home per year. Those numbers may have shifted a little bit. This is the last report I got. Also, other senior facilities, there's an 18-month waiting period. And not only that, as I mentioned, we've got over 400 homeless kids here in the county, though. I know that the homeless situation can mean that they may be staying with grandparents or whatever, but I think there's a large affordable housing issue, and I would like to have spent some of that money in that area. However, I would have supported building one and not spending quite as much money as we're spending. I do know that $1 million of that is for grading, and $1 million of that could be raised by the group that's supporting it. So I would have liked to have used that $1 million and not borrowed as much money, and also possibly looked or seen what we could do to get away from this $1 million grading situation.
Thank you. Mr. Rogers hinted at our next question. County issued report states that we are currently experiencing an affordable housing crisis. But the word affordable contains 2 concepts. It's partially the price the seller wants, and it's also the buying power of the purchaser. Is the solution to our affordable housing crisis to push for lower priced housing or higher median incomes in the county? Mrs. Black?
It's both. It's both. We need to raise the median incomes in Haywood County, and we need to bring in affordable housing. I spoke with a lady that's on the board of one of the public housing authorities. They met yesterday, and it's my understanding there's something in the works between a couple of the recent public housing authorities in Haywood County. I've been lucky. I worked for a long time in public housing. I managed a public housing for 5 years so I have a unique experience and knowledge in this area. I have 10 years audit experience in auditing housing programs, Section 8, and public housing and their capital fund programs. And this gives me a lot of background and knowledge of actually working with the people in public housing. And it's difficult to break that cycle. I had 3 generations of the same family in my housing project. I couldn't get them out. I couldn't get the kids to go to work. I couldn't do anything. It's a struggle every day to find affordable housing in this county and to break the cycle of poverty. And it goes hand in hand. To quote your article, right now the average renter wage in Haywood County is $9.83. It takes them 63 hours a week to rent a 2-bedroom house in Haywood County. What ends are they going to afford? When are they going to get the money for the food, clothing, shelter, the kids? That's why the kids are on reduced price lunch. That's why we've got 413 homeless kids. Granted, they may not be out on the street. They may not be out on the street, but they don't have a home. They don't know where they're going when they get home from school. They don't have their own room. They don't know where their stuff's going to be. The affordable housing, we need to do something, and there's plenty we can do about it if we'll all work together.
Mr. Brown.
I agree with Robin that we need to do both. We do need to raise the median income level of people in Haywood County, and we also need to work on the problem of affordable housing. I want to give you a personal story about what I do for a living. As many of you all know, I'm the director of the ARC of Haywood County, which serves individuals with intellectual and developmental disabilities. We have 9 individuals who live in apartments that are within our community, and each one of those receives a Social Security check for $1,073 a month, and the average 1-bedroom apartment in Haywood County goes for $800. How do these individuals live? If it wasn't for the man above and Mountain Projects, which provides a supplement through Section 8 housing for them to do that, plus also we're blessed to have the Evergreen Foundation in Haywood County, which most of our individuals live in, who also give us a break for those individuals to be able to live in there. Another fact that really disturbs me, because I'm a part of that, but in the year 2030, 30% of our population will be over the age of 65, and I will be well over that age and by the year 2030. But a bigger part of the problem is that 33% of the people that live in Haywood County make less than $15,000 a year, and that's because they're on subsidies, they're on Social Security or Medicaid or disability, and it's a real problem that we've got to address. One quick more story, and I know I'm running out of time. We also have another resident, an individual that lives in our program, who has been on the waiting list at the Waynesville Towers for almost 18 months now, trying to get placement, because that is the only place that he's able to afford to live. He's now living in a unit from his parents, and the parents are selling the home, and he's going to have to find alternative housing. And folks, there is no alternative housing in Haywood County, and I applaud the commissioners for doing this assessment that was done in, I believe it was August of 2016. You all need to take a look at this and look at the stuff, the facts and figures that are in this. And we as county commissioners, and we as you in this room, need to work together with this task force to come up with recommendations to find affordable housing for everyone in Haywood County.
Commissioner.
Yeah, we did the study. We actually had a staff member on our staff that was able to do the study, which would have cost $15,000 to $20,000, and she did a great study. She's identified what the needs are. Just to give you an idea, Mountain Projects has a 600-person waiting list for housing. That list was closed in March. You can't get on the list, and it was 600. So that's how extreme it is. But some of the solutions, and we're starting to look, as our community moves forward, we're starting to look for solutions. Some of the solutions I would like to see, and I'd like to support to come from the private sector, is to work with our towns where the water and sewer is located, because where the water and sewer is located, that's where you have, where you're able to place more houses, and maybe work with the zoning with the town and maybe show them how to do, there's a name called Granny Flats, or it's just like we can put a smaller house on the property, maybe if they have the amount of room, and show property owners how to do that. Maybe where builders are that build those type of homes, and maybe even have a type of home that we can kind of all go towards, like you could see in Phillipsville and Canton, where you have these little row houses and stuff that the mills used to put up for families. They put up for their families because they had somewhere to live. So I think if we can work with them with water and sewers located, then we can build the smaller houses. The property owner builds those houses. He gets an income from having a rentable unit, and it helps our affordable housing issue because it's now affordable because they're not huge homes. Also, we've worked with we found when we couldn't do the hospital with the tax credits, we've been able to find there are other tax credits available for the old hospital, and we're starting to look towards those other sources, and we have a contact person for that, because since we weren't able to get the tax credits that the state was offering, there are other types of those. So we're hoping to get that project going and get some affordable housing in there. That's going to take care of our veterans and our seniors and maybe even families. So that's where we're headed, you know, and hopefully if I'm reelected, we'll head in that direction. Continue.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes, I would support raising the median. You know, nothing breaks my heart more than, like I mentioned earlier, having over 400 homeless kids here in the county, along with some of our seniors that don't have a home. You know, each one of us in this room tonight is probably going to have a home to go to when we leave here. And I don't look forward to anything else, you know, especially after a long day. I've been at the polls all day, and I've done this to go home and just be with my family and be in my own home. You know, that's something special I think each and every one of us cherish. Even when I'm going away, if it's traveling or on vacation, I love the vacation, but I still can't wait to get home. Like I said, it breaks my heart to know that we have situations here in our own county where kids can't call a home home. You know, they may be staying at one place one night, going somewhere else the next. Even our seniors, as I mentioned earlier, they don't even have, some of them don't even have a home. So that is one of my top issues that I'm a big supporter of. Another thing that I was talking with Mr. Joan Kennedy here a few weeks ago, and she is telling me how important a group home is needed here in the county. We currently have kids going to Swain and Franklin. I don't know how many of you guys know that, but again, people that live here in Haywood County or go to school here in Haywood County should be able to have a home here as well.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Mrs. Black.
Okay. I don't think we need to go back to row houses, tenements, old mill houses. That gives a connotation to the area, a negative connotation. I think what we need to look at mixed income housing, which is pretty much on the forefront of affordable housing in this country, and where you have seniors, you have disabled people, you have working families that make a ton of money, you have people that are poor, and it's in a mixed income development, so that nobody drives by and says, oh, everybody that lives in this row of similarly looked ugly houses are poor. It's a connotation that you can't, it's a barrier to breaking the cycle of poverty. If you take people that are low income and put them in a mixed income housing project with people that have better incomes, the crime is better, they have more, the crime is less, so the quality of life is better. So I think that's where we need to go, mixed income housing, not row houses.
Commissioner Inslee, you'd like to respond to that?
Yeah, I want to talk about, I was just using that as an example. And you remember those little row houses, they were little, they were small. What I'm talking about is, you go throughout Waynesville and maybe the lot is a fairly large size lot and you can put a home on it, a smaller home. And so you do, and then you accomplish what Rob was talking about, you do have the mixed use, because I think you do need that. You see that in Florida a lot, where you'll have expensive homes and you'll have townhomes and you have all different income levels all in the same neighborhood. And I think by property owner taking advantage of their lots because they have some extra room on it to put a smaller house, whereas maybe the town of Waynesville won't let you because of the setback, you can't maybe get that size house in the area, but you can do the smaller house and they can lower the square footage on, you know, when you, I'm a surveyor, so I know this. When you have a big lot, then the town has zoning, and they say, well, you can only put one house on this lot. But if the lot's big enough and has room for a smaller house, let's try to look at the zoning laws and see how we can change those to help reflect and help a property owner, because that's a private property solution, be able to maybe put a rental home there and help, or maybe even an income for his daughter or mother-in-law or something. And that's kind of what, it was also the same thing. I was just trying to use, I just remember looking at row houses thinking that's how mills took care of their families and stuff.
Yeah. Anyone else want to respond to that, Mr. Brown?
No.
Okay. Mr. Rogers?
No.
All right. thank all the candidates for coming tonight and answering the questions. We're going to give you all 2 minutes real quick to go ahead and wind up and tell all these people right here that came to see you tonight why they need to vote for you. Let's start with Mrs. Black once again.
Gosh, I always lead off everywhere. I mean, every question tonight starts with me. As most of you know, I'm a certified public accountant. That's what I am. I'm an accountant. I'm not a real good politician. I'm trying. I'm getting better. I'm a taxpayer of Haywood County, and to me, that's the most of my three most important issues are the tax dollars, the children, and the seniors. Those are the three areas that I concentrate and worry about. While we're sitting here tonight talking about the issues and our solutions, either whether they're similar or different, depending on who you're talking to, tonight in this county, some children and some seniors are going to bed hungry. That's where my concern is. That's why I'm up here pushing myself outside my comfort zone, because this is really difficult. It's easy to talk about issues when you're talking with friends or family and like-minded people. You get out in the public, put yourself out there, start talking about your issues, put your family out in the public. It's difficult, and it takes real dedication to stick with it, just to try to see that the county that I leave my children is better than the county I got. We were talking about mill houses. My grandfather worked at the mill for a quarter a day, one of them, hauling wood on his back. My mom lived in Wellstown on dirt floors, okay? My father wanted to drop out of school in the eighth grade because he was embarrassed he was wearing overalls. That's all they had. This is where my concern is, and that's why I'm here tonight. And I'll promise you that if you'll vote for me, I'll vote for you for the next 4 years.
Thank you, Mrs. Black. Mr. Brown.
I'm so glad we get to do this because I've been sitting here for the entire night and I'm dying to talk about this school. This is my community. I grew up, I was raised less than a mile from here. I currently live less than a mile and a tenth from here. And I attended this wonderful school. I went through the fifth and sixth grade here. My three sons also attended this school and went and graduated from here and went on to Waynesville Middle School. This is home for me. I used to park a Schwinn bicycle right outside this door, and I used to ride it from my house to school and back. Wouldn't it be great if we could do that again? My parents trusted me to be able to do that, to ride back. Also, I have to tell you, there's the last room on this, going down this hallway right here, is the principal's office. And I guess I'm gonna have to tell on myself, but occasionally had to visit that door because the principal was telling me that as the fourth son of five boys and a sister that I occasionally got into trouble and had to see the principal. But I'm real excited you all came here tonight to be in the community that I've grown up in and I've lived for over 62 years, almost 63 years of my life. I also want to mention I have two wonderful daughter-in-laws and I have four grandchildren. Can I repeat that? I have four grandchildren and I'm so excited to be a grandfather. As I've told you all, I'm the executive director of the ARC of Haywood County. And I want to talk just briefly about, obviously, education and jobs is the most important thing to most of us on this stage. We did not talk a lot this evening about broadband internet, but all of us support that and are very interested in that. And Representative Queen here is very involved in that too. And I hope that this county can provide that extra mile to be able to provide high-speed broadband internet to every resident in Haywood County. But not only that, but we need to do it at an affordable price. We have the New Meridian, John Fiker, alderman from the town of Waynesville, pays $200 a month for whatever gigabytes that he gets. But in Raleigh, North Carolina, that same rate is $50. We've got to work to get not only broadband internet, but we've also got to get it at an affordable price. For the last 40 years, I've spent living in this community. I've served on at least a dozen nonprofit boards. I've been the director of three different foundations in this county, and I've raised funds for the school system. I've raised funds for the hospital, and now I'm currently raising funds for the ARC of Haywood County, which, by the way, tomorrow night we're having our Oktoberfest. It's 6 o'clock at Wells Event Center, and we still have tickets available. We'd love to have you come. And I've been told by sources that the executive director may possibly be dressed in a tutu, but we'll leave that for another evening. But I am truly blessed to live in this county. I'm truly blessed to live here, and I'm truly honored to be able to stand up here or sit up here tonight and be around these three other great candidates who have also committed a large portion of their life in order to run for Haywood County Commissioner. I want to close by asking each one of you, if you haven't already, how many people have already voted today? If you have, raise your hand. Awesome. How many people are planning on voting? Thank you. Everybody raise your hand, because we're all going to vote. Well, if it isn't today or tomorrow or up to November 8th, I want you to walk into that voting booth. I want you to come down to Steve Brown and check my name. And then I want you to join me, my family, and have Haywood County become a place where me and my family and 59,000 other people call home. Thank you, and I look forward to seeing each of you in this community over the next few years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Commissioner Ensley?
Yeah, I want to thank everybody that's here tonight for coming, especially for Corey and Scott smoking out news and hosting this. I just want to, you know, I've been a county commissioner for 12 years, and I just wanted to touch on some of our accomplishments. I'm going to use the word we, because as a commissioner, you work as a team. There's five of you, it's like a basketball team. It's not like a boxing match, it's a basketball team. You have to work together to get things done. In the first term, we passed board rules, which made our board more transparent. We televised their meetings, and we wouldn't put anything on the agenda unless it was on the agenda. We just didn't, you know, put it on there and vote on it. If it wasn't on the agenda, we don't do it. I was elected in 2008 for my second term, and we were proactive, and we bought the old Walmart for the DSS and health department. It revitalized that shopping center, and it was located in the center of the county. We were able to locate more offices there, and so I was proud of that. It saved the county $12 million because they were telling us it cost $25 million to do that. We were proactive when that space was available in the middle of the county, and it was already ready. All we had to do is we spent $12 million instead of $25 million, so we saved $12 million by doing that. We privatized the landfill. That saved, over the next 30 years, $59 million that you get to keep in your pockets. $59 million, it's about $2 million a year. If we hadn't done it, then your availability fee would be another $60 right now. We partnered with Mountain Project to deliver senior services. Instead of hiring county staff, they did that. Now we were the second oldest county in the state. Now they take care of our senior services, and I think that's a great thing. Well, in my third term, we were able to, which is my last term in the last 4 years, we partnered with Haywood Pathway Center, and that's taking care of our homeless situation and reduced our jail recidivism rate. It's going to cost $1 million to add on to our jail. Faith-based programs work. This proves it. Our jail is now, it has 130. There's maybe less than 90 there most of the time, and it was busting at the seams, and the sheriff was looking at us for $1 million. Now he doesn't have to, and he was part of the solution to that. I want to congratulate him and the churches for doing that. We completed the sale of Duke Life Hospital to Duke Life Point. I think that was a highlight too. We've also last two terms have been very tough economic environment, just to tell you the truth. And our debt today is less than it was in 2008. Our county tax rate is 24th in the state out of 100 counties, so 76 counties about higher rate. We've been able to expand the water and sewer. We've added jobs at Freightliner, Chick-fil-A, and there's others. There's more stores coming. You'll be hearing about them soon. And I'm in favor of increasing our funding for our schools and our community college. I have a record of doing that. And I promise you that I will continue to weigh, to find all the facts, and I'll weigh out the facts, and I'll vote for what is best for the county, regardless of personalities, parties, or any other thing. I'm going to find the facts, and I'm going to vote what's best for the county, no matter what. And that's what I've done, and I think that's what my record speaks to. And I would hope that you would look at my whole body of work as a commissioner and a November 8th vote for me and continue to move Haywood County in a positive direction. I want to thank you, and God bless you all for coming tonight.
Thank you, Commissioner. Mr. Rogers?
I hope you're right, Commissioner. I'd like to thank Corey and Scott and Smoky Mountain News, and of course the cameraman and the little red card lady that keeps waving at us real friendly. But we appreciate you guys having us here tonight. Thank you to the people that's endured this and held on and listened to us four candidates. We appreciate your time. I want you to know how serious I am about this. I've never done nothing like this before in my whole life. Never got into politics like I have at this extent, and boy, have I learned a lot. I have my youngest son is playing the second game that I've ever missed in his whole life tonight. And by the way, they won 46-16, and he threw three touchdown passes. Thank you. But I hate I missed that. I've not missed anything as the kids have come through the years. Family is important to me, but this is also important to me. The county's important to me, and I want you guys to realize that and see that. I love Haywood County, and I love living here. Like I said, I've lived here all my life. As a small business owner, I work hard to make a living here just like many of you, and I'm dedicated to help us all prosper in this community. Our needs and our priorities have to line up with our finances, and I can assure you that I'll be responsible for y'all's hard-earned money. I want to help Haywood County residents thrive here and enjoy life here. I will be a consistent voice for quality of life issues, and I will fight for education, job creation, public safety, fiscal responsibility, and to ensure the highest quality of life for our residents. I want to make this county sustainable so that our kids will one day want to return here after college and seek jobs. As commissioner, I will turn obstacles here in Haywood County into opportunities, and I will serve the people in this county above politics. I will make cost-effective decisions, and I want you to hear this. I will be a voice for our people and our community. I respectfully ask for your support and your vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers, and thank you to all the candidates. If we can please have a round of applause. On behalf of the Smoky Mountain News, thank you all for coming tonight. Please drive safely, and we'll see you at the polls.
Good evening.